Bookstore Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Eating Disorders, The Basics, by Elizabeth McNaught, Janet Treasure, and Jess Griffiths. Narrated by Rachael Beresford. 1. Introduction, Jess Griffiths. Context. Eating disorders affect an estimated 1.25 million people in the UK. They are complex mental illnesses that can present in many different ways. Anyone can be affected by them. Within this book, we will attempt to outline the main eating disorders, namely anorexia nervosa, bulimia nervosa, binge eating disorder, other specified feeding or eating disorder, pica, rumination disorder, and avoidant restrictive food intake disorder. The book has been written as part of the Routledge Basics series to offer information about eating disorders that is accessible for all. The content is suitable for school and healthcare professionals, students, and family members. The authors come with a wide range of experience to guide you through the journey from identification, treatment, and to recovery. Within the chapters, you will hear the stories of people who have experienced eating disorders, as well as those who have supported people through them. Our hope is that listeners will feel equipped, inspired, and more confident to support people experiencing eating disorders. Meet the authors. Elizabeth McNaught is a GP and co-founder and medical director of Family Mental Wealth. She is the author of Life Hurts, A Doctor's Personal Journey Through Anorexia, and co-author of Eating Disorders, an Oxford Specialist Handbook in Psychiatry. Professor Janet Treasure is a professor at King's College London and a consultant psychiatrist at the South London and Maudsley NHS Foundation Trust. She has edited 7 academic texts on eating disorders and co-authored 3 self-help books. Jess is a therapist specialising in eating disorders and works as the national co-lead for FREED, First Episode Rapid Early Intervention for Eating Disorders, at the South London and Maudsley NHS Foundation Trust. She has lived experience of an eating disorder and is fully recovered. We start the book in Chapter 2 with an overview of eating disorders and will outline the research that explores the causes, vulnerabilities, and triggers to eating disorders. The diagnostic criteria for eating disorders are explained, and the comorbid conditions that often present alongside are outlined. There is also an introduction to the National Institute for Clinical Excellence, NICE 2017, guidelines on the assessment and evidence-based treatment of eating disorders. Our typical image of a person who has an eating disorder might be of a white, middle-class adolescent girl. But the reality is that anyone of any age, ethnic background, gender, or class can be impacted by them. Chapter 3 discusses diverse presentations of eating disorders and how people from underrepresented groups may struggle to reach out for support and the possible reasons for this. Chapters 4 to 10 outline each of the named eating disorders, the risk factors for their development, how a healthcare professional may assess and diagnose them, and the brief outline of the evidence-based treatments. It's not about food. If I'd learned early on that food was numbing what I was feeling, and that I needed to learn strategies to cope with difficult feelings that weren't self-medicating, I could have started that much earlier. Christina Taylor, Lived Experience of Anorexia Nervosa. Eating disorders are treatable illnesses that often require support from a multidisciplinary team, MDT. Treatment for more serious physical complications around eating disorders often requires medical and dietetics input and intervention. Chapter 11 outlines the most up-to-date evidence-based treatment for eating disorders, according to the NICE 2017 guidelines. Over the next year, I was fortunate enough to receive a range of treatments, seeing a psychotherapist and occupational therapist, a psychiatrist and a dietitian. Instead of going to lectures and club nights, I was going to doctor appointments and therapy sessions. Instead of revising for exams, I was poring over meal plans. I wanted to get better. I wanted to get back to my life and get rid of the cruel eating disorder voice that plagued my every waking thought. But, like most people with anorexia, I did not want to gain weight. I was adamant that it wasn't necessary to recover, despite everything my treatment team were telling me. Laura Hanton, lived experience of anorexia nervosa. Family support is vital to the effective treatment of eating disorders. In Chapter 12, we outline the therapies that family are involved in and the skills that carers and supporters learn about to support loved ones through the illness. The first people who became aware were my amazing parents. They very quickly acknowledged that there was a problem and tried everything they could to get treatment and support for me. Adam Fair, lived experience of other specified feeding eating disorder. Eating disorders are treatable illnesses that people fully recover from. In Chapter 13, we'll discuss the letters of hope and the advice that is offered from the perspective of lived experience and how individuals reached a place of recovery and a life free from an eating disorder. Never, ever give up hope. Hold the hope for your loved one when they are not able to hold it for themselves. Recovery is possible at any age and stage. Suzanne Baker, lived experience of caring for two daughters with anorexia nervosa.
If I could go back in time and give advice to the younger me, or to someone else in a similar position, it would be this. Don't give up. Keep fighting and let your loved ones fight for you as well. The hardest step is to realize you're not an island and cannot do it all yourself. But most of all, find out who you really are. Not who others think you are. Not what your school grades suggest you should do in the future. Find what you want to do, what you love, and pursue that. The happiest I have ever been is doing things I love and supporting others. Find your passion and you will be able to thrive.
Adam Fair, lived experience of other specified feeding or eating disorder. Try and think about who you are as a whole person and what's important to you. Find your reasons to recover, whatever they may be. I would also say to reach out for support. Eating disorders can be such a lonely, dark place, but you don't have to do it alone. There is help out there. And reaching out doesn't always mean talking. I started by writing a letter to my stepmom. So there are ways to get your voice heard. Find what works for you. Jess Sharman, lived experience of other specified feeding or eating disorder.
The main message we want to send is that full recovery is possible. Although it was sometimes hard, we always maintained an atmosphere where communication without anger, frustration, or judgment was possible. Patience and listening with loving understanding were the keys to us coming through to the other side of eating disorders.
David Griffiths, lived experience of caring for his wife with anorexia nervosa and bulimia nervosa. 2. Eating Disorders Overview. Professor Janet Treasure. Introduction.
The profile and prevalence of eating disorders has changed rapidly over the last 40 years, since bulimia nervosa, BN, was described as a possible variant of anorexia nervosa, AN, in 1979. Since that time, various forms of binge spectrum disorders have emerged. Environmental factors, such as changes in the food environment, and the stigmatization of obesity and valuation of leanness have contributed to the changing form and epidemiology of eating disorders. The belief that eating disorders only occur in privileged white females has now been dismissed as a myth. It is now recognized that the population at risk of developing problems with eating are diverse in terms of various socio-demographic features, such as age, gender, sexuality, and ethnicity. Eating disorders may be triggered by both general adversities or by specific traumas relating to eating and body image. The genetic vulnerabilities associated with eating disorders are an area of active investigation, although currently AN is the only form of eating disorder with a sample large enough to be informative. The changes in eating behaviour and the associated social and physical consequences can interrupt development and produce secondary effects that maintain the illness. The what, how, and why of eating disorders. The form of eating disorders has diversified and increased since Sir William Gull, a UK physician, and Charles Lesage, a French psychiatrist, first introduced the concept of AN to the medical community in the 19th century. The next milestone was the description of BN, initially considered to be an ominous variant of anorexia nervosa. This was characterized by recurrent compulsive episodes of loss of control, binge eating, followed by extreme compensatory behaviors such as purging, often accompanied by shame. While many components of eating disorders are insidious, creeping on you slowly, convincing you are in control rather than the eating disorder, the nature of bulimia, binging and purging, meant that pretty quickly I knew a line had been crossed. Bulimia can often feel like a failed or lesser eating disorder, so challenging this in myself and trying to recognize I deserve help and that this isn't my fault is definitely a work in progress. Marina. In the 21st century, the most common forms of eating disorders are binge eating disorder, BED, and other variants of disordered eating, subsumed under the diagnostic label of other specified feeding or eating disorders, OSFED. Also, avoidant restrictive food intake disorder, ARFID, rumination disorder, and PICA, which were previously within the category of childhood disorders of eating, have been added to the wider category of eating disorders in both the American and the World Health Organization diagnostic manuals. Some of the eating disorder variants differ by gender. Bigorexia / muscle dysmorphic disorder tend to occur more commonly in men. Or with comorbidity, such as in people with type 1 diabetes, sometimes labelled as diabulimia. Some of these are outlined in Table 2.1. Type 1 diabetes with disordered eating, T1DE. People with type 1 diabetes are 2 to 3 times more likely to have an eating disorder. This form of eating disorder is sometimes also known as diabulimia, because one aspect of this eating disorder variant is to omit or reduce their insulin requirement as a means of purging. In addition, a range of other problems with diabetes management may also be manifest. Many diabetes services have developed the expertise to manage this form of complexity. Table 2.1. Potential emerging variant forms of eating disorders. Disorder. Reverse anorexia. Bigorexia. Muscle dysmorphic disorder. Symptoms. Drive for muscularity, leanness and tone, rather than thinness, often seen in men. Associated with the use of medications or nutritional supplements to bulk up. Disorder. Type 1 diabetes with disordered eating, T1DE, diobulimia. Symptoms. Reduction in insulin used as a means of weight loss or to manage emotions. Disorder. Food addiction. Symptoms. Gradually the size and frequency of eating and overconsumption increases. Highly processed food is incriminated. Disorder. Orthorexia. Symptoms. Food choice limited to clean or healthy food at a cost to well-being. By my late 20s, I was in full-scale diabetes burnout, a state of mental and emotional overwhelm from managing diabetes 24/7. I neglected my diabetes care, skipped insulin, and stopped caring about my physical and mental health. I began managing my glucose levels by restricting carbs instead of using insulin. Diabetes self-care felt overwhelming, and I wanted to avoid it at all costs. This short-term relief of avoidance led to many hospital admissions from life-threatening diabetic ketoacidosis. My body couldn't sustain the restriction of carbs and insulin, and my attitude towards food became unhealthily obsessive. The only option was an inpatient admission to an eating disorder unit. There was a lot of work to be done around safely reintroducing insulin, weight restoration while managing carbohydrate counting, and the mental health challenges that brings. Recovery took much longer than I anticipated, but I'm safely managing my diabetes independently now, and have learned coping strategies for when diabetes feels relentless and burnout hits. Every day I'm faced with the temptation to return to eating disorder behaviours, simply because type 1 diabetes requires counting carbs and responding to numbers multiple times a day. Self-compassion is the only thing that keeps me from falling off this tightrope. Self-compassion has taught me that those numbers don't define me. Whether that be blood sugar, carbs, insulin, or weight, numbers are data, not a grade or a measure of my worth. Nay Parnell. Food addiction. Research into the neuroscience of eating disorders has led to the introduction of the concept of food addiction. There is an obvious overlap with binge eating disorders, but the concept remains controversial. The epidemiology of eating disorders. As new forms of eating disorders are described, the reported figures for the incidence and prevalence change. Thus, after Gerald Russell named and described BN in 1979, an increase in the number of cases of BN presenting to primary care in the UK followed. Similarly, an increase in binge eating disorders and other forms of eating disorders followed the diagnostic changes made in DSM-5, Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders. However, the exact prevalence and incident rates of eating disorders are uncertain, as many people do not recognise their symptoms as part of an illness and or do not present for treatment. While I had struggled with food and my body image for as long as I could remember, anorexia took hold swiftly and my life transformed within a few short months. I became isolated, obsessive, and terrified of any and all situations involving food. Yet I refused to believe I had an eating disorder. I didn't think I was ill enough or thin enough to have anorexia. I believed that I was fine and could stop these weird habits and behaviors whenever I wanted to. I ignored the concern in my friends' faces and the fear in my sister's eyes and the worry in my mum's words. I thought they were all just overreacting. Laura Hanton. Approximately 10% of the female population, and a lower prevalence in males, have some form of eating disorder during their lifetime. For the most part, these are within the binge spectrum of disorders, whereas the lifetime prevalence of disorders associated with being underweight with restricted eating, AN and ARFID, is lower, at approximately 2%. All forms of eating disorder are often comorbid with other conditions. For example, over 20% of people with AN are comorbid with obsessive-compulsive disorder, OCD, and a smaller proportion may be comorbid with autism spectrum disorder, ASD. The traits associated with ASD, such as sensory sensitivity, perfectionism, comfort from following rules, problems with uncertainty and ambiguity, and social difficulties, victim of bullying or exclusion, often become entangled with the illness. In some cases, the two forms of neurodiversity, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD, which is more commonly seen in those with binge spectrum disorders, and ASD, coexist and can pull in different directions. Another really difficult part has been managing these permanent issues, being autistic and ADHD, and having an eating disorder. Each one of these sorts of contradicts the other. My autism needs routine and hates change. My ADHD needs change and is very impulsive. Adam Fair. The environmental setting for the development of eating disorder. The rapid changes in the form and prevalence of eating disorders in the last 50 years suggests that environmental factors play a role. Changes in the food environment that have been implicated include food poverty, ultra-processed foods, and a reduction in shared, home-produced meals. Concurrently, with these changes in the food environment, social media has disseminated the value of leanness and the stigmatization of larger bodies. These factors have also been implicated in the parallel increase of obesity. The shared and differing risk factors between obesity and eating disorders has made prevention efforts complex. I can recall struggling with my body image from around age 7. I grew up in a household where diets and bodies were talked about frequently, and I started to become interested in weighing myself by year 6, though didn't at that time understand too much about what those numbers meant. I remember looking through Weight Watchers paraphernalia and having the red, bad foods scarred into my brain, quickly learning that red foods meant weight gain, and weight gain was bad. It was around this age that I began comparing myself to other children, always measuring my thighs in my gymnastics leotard to the girls around me, or scanning holiday Polaroids to see if I looked bigger in my swimming costume than the other children by the pool. Cara Lizette. COVID, a natural experiment. COVID-19 was associated with a marked increase in the presentation of eating disorders. There was an increase in the presentation and admission of cases of severe AN, for instance. Some of the environmental changes during lockdown mapped onto the risks known to be associated with AN. For example, the key role of isolation echoes a quote from a doctor with the lived experience of AN. I was recently asked to sum up my experience of anorexia nervosa in one sentence. Actually, I can do it in just one word. Isolation. Other potential contributing factors include increased screen time, leading to a higher exposure to social media, and an increase in fat talk, with concerns about weight gain, exemplified by the Quarantine 15, reports of 15 pounds or 7 kilograms weight gain during lockdown, and weight stigma, concerns about a higher mortality risk from COVID-19 in intensive care amongst those with larger bodies. Also, the generalized sense of threat and uncertainty produced a high-risk environment for those with an anxious disposition. Predisposing, precipitating, and perpetuating factors. Environmental exposures interact with more personal forms of vulnerabilities, such as genetic and developmental factors, to increase the risk of developing an eating disorder. The risks for developing an eating disorder can be considered within the headings of predisposing factors, including genetic, environmental, and developmental factors, precipitating factors, those environmental and developmental factors that may have triggered the problem, and perpetuating factors, those that may have developed as secondary consequences of the illness and/or lead to the problem being maintained, as listed in Table 2.2 for AN and Table 2.3 for binge spectrum disorder. Genetic risk factors. Early twin and family studies gave the first hint that genetic factors were involved. Further research into the genetic aspects of eating disorders has shown, using genome-wide association studies, that AN is associated with a genetic profile linked to both the brain and body. Thus, there are associations in the profile of AN and metabolic factors such as low BMI, insulin sensitivity, and variations in the lipid profile, with various psychiatric disorders, in particular OCD. AN could therefore be classified as a form of psychosomatic disorder. Research is currently underway to collect cohorts of patients with the other forms of eating disorders large enough to be informative. Early findings suggest that the genetic profile of AN and binge spectrum disorders diverge in terms of metabolic risk factors. Table 2.2. The predisposing, precipitating, and perpetuating factors for AN. Genetic. Predisposing. Insulin sensitivity. Low lipids. Low body mass index, BMI. Obsessive-compulsive and anxiety traits. Perpetuating. Weak homeostatic forces following negative energy balance. Eating disorder aligns with traits of anxiety, perfectionism, rigidity, and fear of uncertainty. Environment. Predisposing. Adversity. Concerns about shape and weight. Precipitating. Negative energy balance, decreased intake and/or increased expenditure. Stress. Perpetuating. Weight stigma and diet culture. Development. Precipitating. Puberty. Menopause. Table 2.3. The predisposing, precipitating, and perpetuating factors for binge spectrum disorder. Genetic. Predisposing. Insulin resistance, high lipids, high BMI, ADHD, and addiction traits. Perpetuating. Strong homeostatic forces following negative energy balance. Environment. Predisposing. Trauma, social alienation, and minority status due to race, gender, sexuality, poverty, adversity, concerns about shape and weight, family history of addiction.
precipitating. Negative energy balance, decreased intake and or increased expenditure, stress. Perpetuating. Weight stigma and diet culture. Difficulties in emotional regulation, possibly related to childhood adversity. Development. Precipitating. Puberty. Predisposing and triggering environmental events. Specific environmental events during development, for example, trauma and forms of adversity, such as food poverty, discrimination, and alienation due to race, gender, or sexuality, are associated with a higher risk, particularly for binge spectrum disorders. These minoritized vulnerabilities are less commonly seen in AN. Personal stories suggest that in many cases, the triggers for AN may be non-specific adversities. However, it is thought that they gain momentum from the background predisposition, e.g. perfectionistic traits, and the perpetuating factors, such as starvation-related changes that may follow.
I enjoyed what I was doing. That's an uncomfortable truth, right? I'm not glorifying, promoting, or encouraging disordered behaviour, but it's something that is important to be honest about. I got a kick out of it, or at least I had originally. However, that kick got harder and harder to get. I had to work more and more to get any enjoyment out of it. The balance tipped from enjoyment to compulsion. Dave Chawner.
The eating disorder reeled me in with a false sense of security and power. However, I quickly realised I was far from in control, and my behaviours soon became addictive and impulsive. Kirsty Stapledon. The biological and social developmental changes associated with puberty may set the scene for the onset of an eating disorder, possibly through interacting with the risk factors described previously. There is some evidence that menopausal changes may also contribute to risk. An episode of weight loss commonly, although not always, intentionally, caused by food restriction or negative energy balance, possibly associated with increased energy expenditure due to the pubertal growth spurt and/or increased exercise, often precedes the development of an eating disorder. What perpetuates an eating disorder? Eating disorders, particularly AN, often run a protracted course. For example, the average illness duration has been found to be 7 years. One explanation for this is that the disorders may not lead to early help seeking, Chapter 12, and may activate a wide range of physiological, psychological, and social maintaining factors. Metabolic perpetuating factors. An unverified hypothesis is that the genetic metabolic variants associated with AN produce an atypical response to weight loss, characterized by overactivity and restlessness. This increases weight loss, and the homeostatic mechanisms that are normally activated to restore weight have less power. This contrasts with the binge spectrum disorders, in which weight loss is associated with dysphoria, and increased hunger and the appetite drive is strongly increased, leading to binge eating. Sometimes there is an initial overshoot of weight restoration, which perpetuates the drive to diet. That is, weight or appetite might remain higher for a time, but should eventually come back to normal. Another unproven hypothesis to account for binge spectrum disorders is that wide fluxes in glucose due to insulin resistance and binging behavior on foods, which produces rapid fluxes in blood sugar, trigger an addictive process that fuels the persisting pattern of fasting and binge eating. The continuing, unregulated weight loss associated with AN
leads to malnutrition. Metabolically, active organs are particularly compromised. For example, the brain, which requires 300 to 500 calories per day to function, compensates by reducing brain growth factors, and adolescents lose 6% of their brain structure in the early phase of the illness. Brain maturation changes that occur during adolescence, such as synaptic pruning, are paused. This adaptation of the brain to starvation leads to secondary problems, including autistic-like features of reduced social expressivity and responsivity. Memory and visuospatial learning are also impacted. Consider this quotation from a qualitative study, which illustrates how memory function during the illness was disrupted. "It's so weird. I feel like I didn't realize, like, how much of it I just do not recall until having to. Like, actively think about it. It's really odd." These secondary effects directly on the brain, or indirectly through the regression of reproductive development during the pubertal process, interfere with the establishment of a mature and secure adult identity. They also explain why early reversal of symptoms leads to a better outcome. Weight restoration is one small part of recovery, but it makes everything else so much easier. You can't do much while your body and brain are in starvation and thinking of nothing but food. I could barely hold a conversation, let alone engage in therapy. It was only once I was a healthier weight and eating regularly that the psychological work started to make sense. I began to understand the underlying reasons for my eating disorder and the things that were keeping it alive, which in turn meant I could make the changes needed to start building my life back up. Laura Hampton. Personality factors. Some of the consequences of an eating disorder become valued through their interaction with predisposing traits such as perfectionism, fear of uncertainty, and anxiety. Professor Walter Kay, an eminent academic in the field, suggests that good traits have been turned to the bad in AN. For example, the traits of anxiety, which include a fear of uncertainty and perfectionism, which can benefit social order, also align with eating disorder rules. Following these rules can be a comfort for people who find uncertainty difficult. Furthermore, the goal of weight loss is strongly reinforced in people with perfectionistic traits. Also, the challenges and uncertainty associated with social milestones can be avoided because of the regression of development. Thus, these traits allow eating disorder habits to become entrenched. Eating disorder values displace the emerging identity, making recovery and future thinking difficult to imagine. Neurobehavioral traits, such as a high appetite drive, are common in binge spectrum conditions. These traits may have had survival advantages in environmental settings, such as food insecurity. Nevertheless, these same traits may have evolved because they may facilitate social functioning within the tribe. Table 2.4. How strong personality factors in AN can cause harm when applied to the eating disorder. Good outcome. Balance life goals between body and mind. Good goal. Optimizing goals within the constraints of time, energy, and value. Trait. Perfectionism. Bad goal. Extreme weight control. Bad outcome. The brain centers that control eating through metabolic homeostatic factors, and those that use cognitive methods such as willpower are in conflict.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.